I previously mentioned that we'd be returning to the root for our notes controller, and with the entity in place, now's the time to do it. So let's head back to the roots control panel and pick up our notes root. And what we're going to do is define a root format for our note root, which will allow the URL to specify a particular item from the database, or a particular entity in this case. If you think about the URL that we use for threads, it looks like slash threads, and then the title of the thread, sort of separated by underscores, or maybe it's dashes, I don't remember, dot the ID of the thread. And we're going to do something very similar here. And the way we do that is we define the kind of the important information, namely the primary key that we're looking for as an int. And then inside these angle brackets, we're going to say which field should be represented in the URL. So we're going to use user, we're going to use note ID and the title. And then, although we're not going to use it just yet, we are also going to put colon page so that it will respond to pagination later on. So we'll save that out, and now we are ready to start using it. Heading back to the note controller, I'm going to make use of that new root format with an edit action that's going to accept the parameter that is being passed in through the URL. And it's going to look like this. Public function action edit. And then to get access to the parameters that would pass through the URL as part of the root format, we need to use the parameter bag. That's the class that it's attaching to, and the variable we tend to just call params. Once we're in there, we can check for the presence of whatever we called the primary ID that came through the root format as a property of the params object. So let's just check what we called it. And it was, of course, noteID. So we can check for if params noteID, then do stuff. And by doing that, then we can assert that we have a noteID and go and check the database to see that we've actually got one. Now, a shortcut to checking that we've got something is to use the assertItemExists system. And it looks a little like this. Let's say note equals this assertRecordExists. You can see it being suggested at the top there. And then the first parameter is the identifier, which is going to be the one you can see here, demo pad note. And then it's going to be the ID. So that's going to be the primary ID, the note ID. And then we get options for with and phrase keys for errors and things like that. So let's use that. So we want a demo pad note. And then the ID we're passing it is params note ID. And what will happen here is that if there is a note ID specified, then it will check that the record exists in the database. And if not, it will automatically throw an error and say, no, this record doesn't exist. There's no need to manually stop execution. It will handle all of that through because of this assertion. Now, what can also be useful is to take that assertion using the generic record exists and turn it into a custom function that checks specifically for your own record. And I'm going to do that now because it's actually really useful. And it allows us to specify the PHP doc to tell the system what kind of record we're actually asserting exists. So let's do that here. Protected function assert note exists. And now we're not going to need to specify that. So we're just going to need to specify the ID. And let's just check the parameters for assert record exists. Then we've got a with equals null and phrase key equals null. So let's use that. With equals null and phrase key equals null. And then in the body of that, we can return this assert record exists with that and the ID. And then we'll pass in the with and the phrase key so that we get the functionality that is behind that, whatever it may be. And then just to finish off this function, I'm going to add phpdoc like this and specify that it's not a generic entity that it's returning. It is, in fact, a demo pad entity note. And so now I can get rid of this call to assert record exists and replace it with assert note exists. And then I don't need to specify the type. I can just pass the note ID directly. And because it knows that the return value of note is either a failure or a note, then when I start to use note, I should get access to the various parameters and properties of it. So things like user ID and note ID and title and content, all those things that we defined as parts of our note entity. So that's all good. Now that we've got one of those, I'm going to get rid of that and just pass that directly because there's actually code inside the assertRecordExists method that will check to see if the ID that we pass in has been specified or not. So that was a redundant step now that we're using that. And finally, we would then want to do the necessary code to pass the note over to an edit template, and that's essentially all the job that needs to be done. Now, an edit and an add action are fundamentally very similar. They both show a form, and the only difference really is that one of them has some existing data to insert and one doesn't. Now, you may recall that I mentioned that an entity has an intrinsic knowledge of whether it already exists in the database or not. And what that means is that we can create an add and an edit action that have a sort of differing initial step where we either fetch something from the database or create a new one. But following that, we can treat them both exactly the same. So what I mean by that is that we can have a separate action add that essentially just sets up a new note entity, and then we can have both edit and add point to the same code. So let's do that now. Let's have an action add. Public function action add. No parameters because we don't need any. And then we're just going to say note equals this entity manager create demo notepad. And then what we have here is two methods that are essentially in the same state. They both have a note entity. The only difference is that this one will be a note that already exists, and this is one that we just created. So now we can have them both run the same code. So let's make a new function called noteAddEdit that contains the final code to actually put the stuff on the screen. So we'll have a protected function called noteAddEdit, and we'll pass in a note. Notice that I type hinted it there so that it knows that you can only pass a note into this function. And then we'll set up some view params. And the only view params we want at this point are the note itself. And then we'll return a view. And the view is going to be, let's just grab hold of a whole bunch of this stuff. And then we can edit from there. So it's going to be demo pad note edit. I'm going to call it edit for both the add and the edit action. And I'm going to change that to edit, and then the view params is fine. So all we need to do now is to get both of these, the add and the edit function, to pass their code on to noteAddEdit. So we'll return this noteAddEdit the note. And we'll do the same for this one. And so now, essentially, apart from actually building the template, we do now have a complete add and edit action. Of course, an add and an edit action are largely useless without a save action, so let's go ahead and build that now as well. We're just going to make this another action. It's going to be an action save, so public function action save, but this time We will be passing the noteID parameter, so we need to have the parameter bag of params. And then we're going to use assertNoteExists only if we detect that we have a noteID incoming. If we've just saved a new note, there won't be an ID, and so we need to run some different code. So let's branch the code there, depending on whether or not we get a noteID. So if params noteID, then we're going to assert that the note exists, because if there is a noteID, we certainly want to make sure that the noteID that's been specified is valid, and to halt execution and show an error if it's not. Otherwise, if there wasn't an ID specified, we don't need to go and pick up a new one, an existing one from the database. We just need to do the same as we did for the action add. We're just going to create an empty one that we can put our own data into. So we'll just put that in there. And again, now we have a piece of code that doesn't matter whether it's an existing entity or a new one. We can run the same code. At this point, I'm going to branch off into another function so that I can wrap up some functionality in a little encapsulated module. And I'm going to call it noteSaveProcess. And I'm going to pass it my note. Let's just get the correct note there. And then within this, the first thing I need to do is to fetch the submitted data. Namely the title and the content, and I'm going to do that with the controller's input filterer. So it looks a bit like this. I'm going to say input equals this filter. Now filter can take two kinds of arguments. You can either do it like this, title, which is a string, and that will give you the value of title cleaned up to be a string assigned to input. But in this particular case, I'm going to filter multiple items at the same time. So I'm going to put an array in there instead, and I want a title, which is a string, and I want the content, which is also a string. Why am I not input cleaning things like the user ID and the post date? Well, because all of those things are set by default. I don't need to actually pass those around. Once I've got my input, I'm going to then start up a form action, and the form action allows all sorts of simple and common entity-based actions to happen, and will elegantly handle any kind of failures, so it'll present errors in the correct way, etc. So let's do that. Form equals this form action, and then we're going to call form basic entity save on the note with the input that we've just cleaned up. This essentially wraps up pushing that input onto the entity using bulk set, as we saw in a previous video, and then saving it and handling any errors that come back. Once that's done, we'll just return the form to our main controller. So let's call that now, this note save process on the note. And then one thing that you must remember, which is actually something I always forget, is that you must call run. If you don't call run, then essentially you do all the setup, but you don't actually press the button to make it do anything. So note save process and run that. Now, assuming that you make it this far, then we can be reasonably assured that our entity's data has been saved properly, and we've either created a new entity or we've updated an existing one. So now we need to redirect back to usually a list of entities. But in this particular case, as we haven't built that yet, I'm just going to redirect back to the notes index. So how do we do that? Well, normally we return a view, but this time we're going to turn a redirect instead. And then we need to tell it where to redirect to, and for that we need to use the link builder, which is very similar to the link in curly brackets syntax that we used in templates earlier. But in the PHP context, it looks like this. This build link. And then we essentially use the same parameters as we do when we're using the link builder in the templates. So it's just notes with notes slash action if you were going somewhere else. And that is essentially it. So with our add and edit and save actions all complete and doing their job, all that remains is to go and build a form to allow us to actually do the editing. And for that, it's back to the template editor.